looking back. Looking forward. Looking down. Looking up. Looking around. Come, join a journey of exploration to the distant past, to the frontiers of tomorrow, from the infinitely small to the infinitely large. The mysterious, the mundane. Come, let us travel to the horizons of knowledge. This program has been made possible thanks to a generous grant from the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, the Vodafone Egypt Foundation, the OPEC Fund for International Development, and the Carnegie Corporation of New York. Dinosaurs. We all wonder about them. We all dream of them. And sometimes we try to imagine what it would be like to have lived with them, or what it would be like if they were to be alive today. Great books have been written about that. Great films have been made about that. Most notably, the trilogy on Jurassic Park. Remember? But when did the dinosaurs actually exist? Where did they come from? How did they become extinct? What role did they play in the great story of life and evolution? That is our story today, the story of life on Earth. Our story starts with the formation of the Earth from the primeval dust 4.5 billion years ago. The Earth starts collapsing and forming. The Moon is probably formed by a major collision that displaces a chunk of the Earth and whose pieces become captured by the Earth's gravitational pull and gradually become our Moon. The Earth is a violent place. Soon it is covered by oceans and is subjected to huge and constant hurricanes, and the Moon being closer generates huge tides. It is an inhospitable place. But within the oceans, it was more hospitable, and life would start in the sea. From this primeval, inhospitable world that started some 4,600 million years ago, we evolved into the wonderful planet that we know and love. That marvelous, nurturing planet full of life and wonder. How did that happen? It happened over a very long time. So what is the story of life on Earth? Well, to have a sense of perspective, let us assume that the 4.5 billion years of the Earth's life is equal to 1 24-hour day. And we can see here a 24-hour clock that starts with 00000. The first life forms appear in the oceans at about 4 a.m. Here, our clock shows 4:16. As we know from the theory of evolution, life evolved on Earth from a single ancestor that was probably a single cell creature without even a nucleus in the cell. These were called prokaryotic cells. It probably evolved in the oceans and may have looked something like this. Gradually, very gradually, over 1.5 billion years later, some of these little creatures acquired a nucleus and became what we call eukaryotic cells. Cells with nuclei therefore appear at close to 2 p.m. at 13:52 on our one-day clock. Another billion years, and some of them developed into multicellular organisms. That is what we call algae. So algae appear after 7 p.m. on our 24-hour clock. As you can see, 19:12:00. Simple multicelled animals began about 400 million years later, and then things really started humming. Therefore, marine animal life forms appear a little after 9 p.m. or 21:20:00 on our one-day 24-hour clock. Within a few tens of millions of years, we got the arthropods, ancestors of insects, arachnids, and crustaceans. Shortly thereafter, just before 10 p.m., by 21:52:00, we get complex animals, the precursors of fish and amphibians. And around that time, we get a fascinating phenomenon. It is now 21:45:00 on our one-day clock, corresponding to around 530 million years ago, and we are at what we call the Cambrian period. And we suddenly get the Cambrian explosion. It is a relatively very rapid appearance of a period of many million years of most major groups of complex animals as found in the fossil record. Before about 580 million years ago, most organisms were simple cell creatures occasionally organized into colonies. Over the following 70 or 80 million years, the rate of evolution accelerated by an order of magnitude, as defined the extinction and origination rate of new species. And life appeared to become about as diverse as life today. We do not know quite why, but most of these creatures died out. They disappeared. Only their fossils remained.
We have a fossil record of complex forms that goes back about 545 million years, something like that. But actually, the oldest fossils known are these bacteria that are 3.5 billion years old. So that's a whole gamut of time that we work with.
Some survived. Insects are direct descendants of the arthropods with their exterior armor or exoskeleton.
For millions of years, species can remain recognizably the same.
And so, after a while, the Cambrian explosion is over, and the large number of the creatures that flourished have become extinct. But life goes on, and the surviving creatures multiply and evolve. It was not to be the last mass extinction on Earth. In fact, the so-called Permian-Triassic extinction event, the Great Dying, as it's sometimes referred to, was an extinction event that occurred about 250 million years ago. On that occasion, up to 96% of all marine species and 70% of terrestrial vertebrate species became extinct. And it is the only known mass extinction of insects. 57% of all families and 83% of all genera were killed. Because so much biodiversity was lost, the recovery of life on Earth took somewhat longer than after other extinction events. But let's get back to the Cambrian explosion. The Cambrian explosion, in creating so much biodiversity, has generated extensive scientific debate. The explosion probably represents a threshold being crossed. For example, a threshold in genetic complexity that suddenly allowed a vast range of morphological forms to be employed, to rapidly expand, to fill in ecological niches in the water habitats. Fish appeared, first as cartilaginous fish like sharks and rays, and they have continued pretty much as they were for all that time. And the first vertebrate fish appear, it is called the coelacanth, and it looks like this. Now take a good look. I shall be coming back to this creature in a while. Indeed, not much later, at about 10 p.m., around 22:00 on our 24-hour clock, there is another similar one-time explosion, that of the land plants. The plants on land help change the atmosphere and make it more suitable for breathing by animals, although some amphibious animals may have already been there quite early on. After a fairly cryptic history beginning at about 450 million years ago, land plants underwent a uniquely rapid adaptive radiation during the Devonian period about 400 million years ago. It is now 22 past 10 p.m., showing as 22:00 on our one-day clock, and 400 million years ago. And the Earth is covered by large forests and seeded plants, and the insects roamed the Earth. By 360 million years ago, around 22:40 on our one-day clock, the amphibians have come into their own. And then, just before 11 p.m., some 300 million years ago, the big creatures appear, first in the oceans and then on land. It is the beginning of the age of the dinosaurs. Some lived in the sea and were very large. The dinosaurs include the vegetarian giants like Brontosaurus and Diplodocus, the largest animal to have walked on Earth. And they include many predator meat eaters. And the most fearsome predator of all, the Tyrannosaurus Rex, or the T-Rex. Here we are in the Dinosaur Hall of the Natural History Museum in Washington, D.C. And over my shoulder is the most fearsome of all the dinosaurs, Tyrannosaurus Rex, king of the carnivorous reptiles that ruled the Earth up to 65 million years ago. Some were well armed, like the Stegosaurus. Some relied on their speed to escape predators. At 20 past 11, showing as 23:20 on our one-day clock, about some 200 million years ago, the first mammals appear. They seem to be little rodent-like creatures, like this little fellow that the Smithsonian recreated here. 20 minutes before midnight, 150 million years ago, and the birds take to the skies. They are descended from the reptiles. In fact, we know from their fossils that some dinosaurs had feathers.
Yes, and we can actually tell from the shape of the bones how big the muscles were that attached to those bones. We can tell from the shape of the teeth and the jaw, quite likely what the animal, what the organism ate. And so we have a lot of the skeleton, which is often what we find, contains a lot of information about what the soft tissue must look like. And also it defines the shape of the organism. We can't always tell what colour it was and things like that, but we get a very good idea of much of its morphology, it's what it looks like.
But even there, in the case of colours, which are interesting because we always, the early reconstruction of dinosaurs were all sort of these grey, black, dark things. They're probably, many of them, pretty colourful. And we see now with some of the new tools that we have, some of the feathered dinosaurs that we're looking at, we can actually go back and look because of the structures and the microstructures that are in there. We can actually trace the colors. Mm. We're finding evidence of these. And now we know many of these feathered dinosaurs had multiple colors. Mm. And when you stop to think, why not? I mean, this is the what we find today.
Some even say that the fearsome Tyrannosaurus rex also had some feather-like adornments. But it certainly did not fly. By a quarter to midnight, or some 130 million years ago, flowers are everywhere. Now the landscapes may have changed, but the dinosaurs continue to rule the earth. Now it is 2 minutes before midnight on our clock. The non-avian dinosaurs and some other creatures have gone extinct, leaving room for the mammals to expand and share the earth with the plants and the insects and other creatures. And mammals gradually predominate. Finally, at about 30 seconds before midnight, hominids appear. The genus Homo is here. And our time clock now reads 23:59:30. And it is only in the blink of an eye, the last few seconds, that modern humans appear some 200,000 years ago. And civilization, which comes some 10,000 years ago, practically at the stroke of midnight. Our clock now reads 24:00:00. Wow, that is quite a story. And if it were not for the disappearance of the dinosaurs some 65 million years ago, they might still be ruling the Earth. So what happened?
I think there's fairly wide consensus in the scientific community that there was a big asteroid impact 65 million years ago. You can see this from the trace of iridium that you find pretty much around the planet over the same period of time. And that clearly had a big impact, but there were probably a number of other factors happening around the time.
Well, actually, it was a physicist, Luis Alvarez, who proposed the solution that most of us have accepted as to why they died out so suddenly all over the Earth. First, we all know that rocks can be aged by scientific methods, and that many of the layers of the Earth correspond to some of these older periods on Earth. Let's go to a second factor, iridium. Iridium is a very rare element on Earth, which is found more plentifully on meteorites and asteroids. So, with these pieces of information, back to the dinosaurs. Why did they all disappear some 65 million years ago? Alvarez, his son, and other scientists were able to show that there was an unusual amount of iridium in the layers of rocks about 65 million years ago, which is about the time of the sudden disappearance of the dinosaurs. And that was a very powerful argument that, in fact, it was an asteroid that hit the Earth 65 million years ago that released this amount of iridium that we now still find, that was responsible for a transformation of the climate and that led to the extinction of the dinosaurs.
The theory known as the Alvarez hypothesis is now widely accepted to explain the demise of the dinosaurs. A large buried impact crater structure with an estimated age of about 65 million years was later identified under what is now the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. And all these large creatures didn't survive. And smaller creatures like the mammals and the birds and smaller reptiles would gradually take over. The insects survived. And evolution would proceed at its steady pace, and it was to be the age of the mammals. And some million years ago, the first hominids appeared, and our own species, Homo sapiens, appeared some 2.5 million years ago, and modern civilization as we know it, with settled agriculture, is probably less than 20,000 years old.
I think the biggest event in human history probably was the invention of agriculture, which took us outside of the local ecosystems. Every other species on the face of the earth, including our own ancestors, including our own species up to about 10,000 years ago, lived in small populations off the fruit of the land, basically. You can't outstrip your environment. Well, if you invent agriculture, you're taking life into your own hands and you're stepping outside of the ecosystems, you're creating settled populations, and it has resulted. The estimates are 10,000 years ago, there were maybe 5 or 6 million people on the planet. There's 7 billion now.
But how far we have come in this very short time. We even built museums where we can admire the fossils of the dinosaurs. We made movies that recreated the dinosaurs. But another question that all of you, our smart viewers, are probably asking is how can we know so much about the dinosaurs when all we have left of them is some bones? Now let me tell you one of the strangest stories about the history of life on Earth. Remember the coelacanth, the first vertebrate fish that appeared a long time ago and that we expected had disappeared some 50 million years ago? What makes the coelacanth interesting is that it was a creature that we thought was extinct and that we reconstructed on the basis of fossils. And then suddenly, in 1938, a real live specimen of a living coelacanth was discovered off the coast of Africa. And what was stunning was that to find the live animal was also to see that the reconstructions that the scientists had made based on the fossil record were actually quite close to what the animal really looked like. Now this, of course, would give us much greater confidence that the way scientists are reconstructing the fossil record is in fact
close to the reality. So when we say that these dinosaurs looked like that based on the fossil record, we can have some confidence, because when we said that the coelacanth would look like that, we did actually discover that it did look like that.
How could the coelacanth be still alive? Well, many other creatures are even older and coexist with us, from the earliest horseshoe crabs to insects and arthropods to the sharks and rays that are the cartilaginous fish. Admire the legacy of the story of life on Earth, from the most modest beginnings to the most spectacular creatures, from the most limited origins to the magnificent diversity of life.
And yet, my friends, this magnificent diversity of life is threatened with extinction, not by the arrival of an asteroid, but by the actions of us, the latest species to arrive and the most successful of the predators and the colonizers, by the continuing pollution of the Earth and its ecosystems that our activities are creating, and by the destruction of habitats. And by all that we are doing, we are threatening our Earth. The terrible process of climate change will have a profound impact on the web of life. How can we save that wonderful web of life? Will people understand the fragility of this web of life? Will people understand in time the enormous risks of our current behavior? Will we have the wisdom to act to protect that rich legacy of life on Earth? That is a story for another day. I am Ismail Serageldin, and I thank you for having joined me in this episode of Horizons.